Welcome again, and thank you once again for attending this seminar. We have our second meeting today with Professor Kes van der Peel from the University of Sussex. I recognize most faces being also present on Friday's class, but as a very short introduction for those who were not present. Is there anybody who was not present on Friday? Excellent. So we have what Professor van der Peel has done on Friday was to illustrate in a very long and long-term overview the what I would call the history of capitalist international relations, starting from the 11th century, explaining how in the British Isles from the 11th century there emerged conditions that allowed for the creation of a limited state, a state who would not overtake completely the society. And that from there, through the Great Charter and through the Act of Supremacy, which regulated the relations between the throne and the church, the Anglican Church in Britain, but also which allowed the king, Henry VIII, to redistribute the church's lands among his friends. The opportunity for accumulation of land was introduced, and from there you had the conditions for the accumulation of the original capital, for the development of the British wool industry, and for the takeoff, the successive takeoff of the British textile and industrial process. We have also seen how this, in many ways, was transplanted with the dialectical process into the other white colonized portions of the Anglophone world, the English-speaking world, particularly what is now the United States of America. And I'm going to conclude this very short summary. Professor van der Peel has explained how this process has in many ways created a an Anglo-American ruling class, a transatlantic ruling class, who has specific characteristics and that has also been endowed with a peculiar ideology of international relations, which tended to normalize international, the concept itself of international relations, and that has always entertained a contentious relation with what Professor van der Peel has called the contender states, starting from France and then moving to Germany, Japan, the Soviet Union, or China today. Contender states characterized by a much greater role of the state over over the society, the civil society, as it would be called in the English-speaking world. We will move from here today and get to new issues, and again, just like we did on Friday, we hope that this will be an informal discussion where the debate is just as important as the lecture itself. So thank you, Professor van der Peel, once again.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks again for the invitation. And thank you for being here on a lovely day. So there's a real alternative. And yes, last Friday I spoke about the long history which has constituted this English-speaking West. And the important point there is really to see that economics, as we know it, so even if it's so-called Marxist economics, is always internal to this broader social relations in which it functions. So the concept of class has the priority, not for some abstract ideological reason, but simply because the power of a community to make itself felt in the world through the exploitation of nature and production, through the relations with other communities, is always a class matter, because there is always a certain group in society, in every type of society across the ages, and in every place that we can think of in the world, there's always one particular group which leads the community into this projection of itself on others and on nature. I hope you see the point. I put it a bit abstractly. And as I said on Friday, for some reason, for many reasons, none of which are coincidental, because there is no coincidence. If we just know enough, then there's no coincidence anymore, although there are contingent things. For instance, the fact that Britain happened to be located on an island, and that made a difference, you know. If it would have been in North Italy, for instance, it wouldn't have had the chance to develop the way it did now, and so on. Also, looking out, the fact that it looked out on the Atlantic Ocean. But before I slip into long history again, today we'll be talking about the 20th century process, and mostly the second half of the 20th century up to the present, to see how this Western society has gone through a unique, I always use the word unique, because the fact that the English-speaking society rose to primacy in world affairs was built on a series of not coincidental, but unique circumstances, unique coming together of several factors. And now we're looking at the fact that in the 20th century, the spread of English-speaking liberal society went through a unique reversal. That is, its spread until then, the spread of its ideas, the spread of liberal ideas, for instance, if we think of the Enlightenment, that was the spread of the idea that religion and the state should be separate, and that society should be allowed a measure of self-regulation from the state. And the social vehicle of that was Freemasonry. I hope you get the term, huh? It's Masonica in Italy. Well, you had a very interesting Masonic lodge here in the Moro episode, and Berlusconi was even a member, but this is just a footnote. Freemasonry in the 18th century and the 19th century was what you might call the liberal international. You know, it was the party, and then we can forget about the rituals, etc., because these were simply necessary so that people from different classes could get into it and join a body where, through the rituals, their former identity, so whether you wore expensive clothes or aristocratic clothes or whether you were just a bourgeois person, where that could be left behind and you would enter this new world. So from the Glorious Revolution on, liberalism had been spreading, and until, well, it's difficult to find a particular date here, but until early 1930s, you might say 1931, the beginning of the big the banking crisis that led to the Great Depression, there was a reversal of this spread. And this is not an idea of mine, it is an idea of Friedrich von Hayek, the Austrian reactionary and revolutionary economist who is the patron saint of neoliberalism. Thank you. And he said that until the 1930s, or until the First World War, that depends on what you see as most important, liberal ideas had been spreading from west to east. And now, he said, very sadly, because he said it in his book The Road to Serfdom, in which he deplores the advancing role of the state in society. And he says, from now on, that is being reversed. So influences from the continent, from contender states like Germany and France, and also from the Soviet Union, of course, in a different way, were spreading in the world. And he wrote that in 1944, 43, 44. So he couldn't yet remotely envisage that in the late 1970s, that reversal would itself be reversed, and that the Western advance in the world would resume. And that's what I want to talk about today. So we have I won't use the word unique again, but we have a very interesting one-off conjunctural shift in which the spread of liberalism comes to a halt at the latest in 1931, remains in reverse until the 1970s, and then in the late 1970s, and 1979 is really the hinge year here, you know, hinge for Italian cardine. So it's the year in which everything is thrown into reverse again. Then the advance of the West resumes. And today we call that globalization, which in one respect is a mystifying term, because it makes us forget that it is the global spread of an Anglophone liberalism, and Anglophone simply, it doesn't mean, of course, any ethnic connection, it's simply the fact that the social forces that were associated with this spread of liberalism happened to have their origin in the English-speaking world, and spread with the help of English. I mean, I already said on Friday, it is worth reflecting on why, it's not a big secret, but it's worth reflecting on why I, as a Dutchman, speak to you as an Italian audience in English. You know, that itself is the undisputable marker of a particular hegemony, an accepted superiority of one type of society. So this is the conjuncture that forms the background to everything, I think, in the modern age. Until 1931, you have the spread of liberalism, and I said Freemasonry was the transnational political party, almost, of that spread. 1931 to 1979, at the latest, we have an interruption, a reversal, really, in which ideas emanating from the contender state context make themselves felt again. So we have to reflect on what happened in that interval, so in the period 1931 to 1979, and we have to reflect on the fact what happened afterwards. And then we understand the historic, or I hope so, of course, and then we understand the historical meaning of neoliberal globalization and what it means politically and economically and socially, even down to the individual level, how we relate to each other as people, you know, as humans, because one of the characteristics of liberalism, which also makes it attractive, and which I would not have understood, I think, if I hadn't lived for 12 years in Britain, is that in the English-speaking context, there is what, they have a beautiful expression for that, and that is at arm's length. So something is away from you at the length of an arm. Now, the alternative to that is that you're in extremely close, you know, and that closeness has, on the one hand, a very reassuring and stabilizing effect, because it means that you're never alone. On the other hand, of course, it has a constraining effect, because none of us wants to be held all the time, you know, 24/7. And then the idea of at arm's length has a greatly liberating effect. And liberalism would not be popular the way it is if it didn't have as its at its microcosmic level, molecular level, this idea of the arm's length, that every human being is like an atom, and between the different atoms there is space for other social forces to move. It sounds a bit exotic the way I put it, but it's really, it's important. Because otherwise we wouldn't be able to understand why highly complex societies, which function according to their own principles, but based on this closeness, on the fact that you are born into a certain social position and you remain there, or you can even move up, but according to very tight systems of regulation, that such societies yield to the influence of liberalism. Because at an individual level, at least at one stage in your life, you also want to be at arm's length from everything, from your parents, from your, well, I'm a grandfather now, so I tend to, I hope that the grandchildren will not have that feeling, but at some point you want to be away from everything. You want to be a social atom. That's the promise of liberalism, and I think when you're young you want that especially, and I think that today American political science and social science has succeeded to a very great extent to begin to understand how you can mobilize this yearning to get, for instance, unwanted regimes in other countries out of the way by mobilizing the young and mobilizing this sense that life is about dancing all the night and about living freely, etc. If we don't understand that, we will not understand what neoliberalism is, because you can talk endlessly about economic models and forms of dominance of money capital over production and so on and so forth, and still you won't get it. There's a deep force inside every person which is driving towards liberation from constraints, because only then can you realize also your full potential. You know, it's not a false promise. It is a promise which has some meaning, but it also has a severe downside, and that is that in the end, we'll end up as very lonely beings, you know, because nobody sits on our neck anymore. And the moment when you throw that person off is fantastically liberating. But at some point, I'm afraid that maybe it's a conservative side of my own personality, a sort of weakness, but at some point you will be yearning, where is this familiar weight on me that kept me in my place? That also works to explain why there are so many conservative aspects to this revolutionary neoliberalism. Why so many people begin to embrace deeply conservative causes, why religion is making a comeback. You know, we shouldn't slip into easy explanations that in times of great uncertainty people dream of heaven again. No, they are dreaming of a conservative society. There's an ambivalent relationship to that. Now, that's a very long introduction. So, having said that, we're always looking at the expansion of a society, and that economics and international politics are internal to that. You know, let us look at what happened in that interval between roughly 1931 and 79, and the dates are necessarily a bit a matter of choice and debate. Now, the first thing that happened in after 1931 was, and this was the period I recall, of which Hayek said, for the first time in history, liberal ideas are no longer spreading from the West to the East, but ideas of social constraint, of a strong state, are spreading from the East to the West. And part of that was caused by the fact that in World War I, liberalism and capitalism and the sort of society that it stands for had lost a lot of its glory. You know, its gloss had disappeared, because we had seen a carnage that the world had never witnessed. And I still think we're now 100 years exactly after the outbreak, well, in a few months' time, after the outbreak of World War I, I still think it's extremely important to reflect on what was lost in terms of human progress and the expectations that a better society was fast coming closer through that war. It was not just the human destruction and the material destruction, it was also the disappearance of hope, which is why so many authors like Hobsbawm and others have reflected on the dark age that followed, in which both the progressive movement, so the socialist movement, darkened into a Stalinist aberration, and in which, of course, you got the worst of all, which was not even your Italian fascism, but of course German National Socialism, because the Germans do everything better and more in a more fundamental and complete way. So what happened after 1931 was that the density of society increased. And I've just explained to you that liberalism is about decreasing the density, opening up the spaces between individuals also. Mind you that, just as a footnote, Calvinism here is a crucial ingredient of liberalism. There would be no liberalism without Calvinism, because Calvinism is the idea that every individual faces God on his or her own, and you're entirely isolated. There's no priest, there is no church, mother church or whatever, that will mediate between you and God. You're entirely on your own. There's again this idea that you are an atom in the whole social circulation of social forces. Now, after 1931, society of a greater density moves out from its epicenters in the European continent. And every part of the world begins to feel this idea of this greater density. And I think that the best term for that is the term that American New Left writers used in the 1960s, where I picked it up, corporate liberalism. It is a liberalism, but a liberalism of bodies, of corporate forces. So you have economic sectors, you have large corporations, you have trade unions, you have blocs in international politics, you have the state. So you're probably familiar with the idea of the corporatist state, you know, in which every force is represented as a solid entity, as an organism, and it deals with others on some form of some principle of sovereign equality or subordination, but always retaining the right to organize itself internally on its own principles. So even classes in an organized way, let's say organized labor and the trade unions, are allowed to organize themselves in their own fashion. And that is not so. We have a whole set of bodies, like, you know, like a stellar constellation, and all these forces negotiate with each other, not necessarily as equals, but as parties which have some sovereignty. And at the same time, of course, they don't do so at arm's length, but they all pack together into one. And that gives you this idea of the contender state, of a state which also embraces its society and keeps its society under tight control. And that leads to the expulsion and the suppression of market forces from society. Because if the only market forces that remain are the relations between the different bodies, but the bodies themselves are without principle of free exchange and market relations, then you can imagine that the whole society, especially if all these forces are firmly packed together like a compact set of atoms, that there is very little market in society. Which is why, in my days still, in the 1960s and early 70s, I studied for nothing, because everybody studied for nothing, and the idea was that you studied because you would find your place in society, and all these things were very neatly programmed for you, whereas you, as I mentioned I think already on Friday, you study as investors, and you're entirely on your own, and if you fail your exams, your neighbor will hardly be affected, because you are in a different universe altogether. You're like free-floating atoms. Now, in the period from the 1930s to the 1970s, therefore, society was compactly put together, and the class aspect, which is always the key element that you must be looking for, the class aspect was organized around a class compromise between capital, the forces of capital, which in themselves were already severely constrained, as I'll explain in a second, and organized labor. That was the central axis of class compromise, around which all other compromises were organized. And as I said, in corporate liberalism, the term corporate liberalism captures best how a society operates in which all these compromises, not just nationally, but also internationally are organized, because in the Cold War, because you know, we're talking about a period that ends with the late 70s, in the Cold War there was an acceptance of blocs. We didn't like the Soviet Union, we didn't like the Soviet bloc, you know, we were told on a daily basis that everything what was being done there was wrong, which is why we did so many things in the same way, like having free medical care, free education, and so on and so forth. But the fact, we didn't attack them directly. They had their bloc, we didn't like it, but they had their bloc. And that is what you have to see is involved in corporate liberalism. Everybody, as it were, is sovereign on its own, but they're all packed together in this dense constellation. Now, I use a lot of time to explain this, but I hope you see the point.
Just a minute. I can recognize several of you also from my History of International, questa tra l'altro va filmata. History of International Relations class. I did not use the word corporate liberalism in class. I referred to John Ruggie's embedded liberalism.
Or less? Yeah, that's the same. That's the same. But I mean, you know, if you're a bit snobbish about it, embedded is a term that comes from the dictionary of the institutionalist school of pragmatism, etc. Institutionalists like Polanyi, Karl Polanyi, or Thorstein Veblen, they use disembedding, embedding, and that is because they're in their view of things, social phenomena are externally related. So, just as when you go to sleep at night, you don't become part of the bed, but you embed, that, you know, you remain different from the sheets and the mattress. So they see every social phenomenon separately, whereas in the historical materialist tradition, things are always, and Hegel already theorized that, mutually interpenetrating, which I hope will not happen when you go to bed, but because it would be quite a job to get out of it again. But in society, that is why you can talk about social relations in a, I think, more dynamic way, because there's this constant, almost physical attraction and repulsion that drives society forward. But the term ultimately refers to exactly the same. But now we get to the economic component, because people, of course, also did something. But I put it a bit in third place to make sure that you see we're not trying to create an economically determinist picture in which capitalism already was there and it determines everything, etc. No, it's an internal set of interconnections in a society. And that society is a class society, also from economic determinants, but also the ruling class is not just the economic ruling class, it's also the political ruling class, that is, it monopolizes the definition of problems and encounters with other societies. Now, what happened with the capitalist economy in that period of class compromise, that period in which the liberal offensive was thrown into reverse after the crisis of 1931, already prepared in many ways by the First World War, the capitalist system at that point was organized around production, because the only way and the natural place that capital and organized labor reach their position of compromise is in production, because there, of course, the workers are organized, they can contribute, etc. And that explains also why from the 1930s in the United States and from under fascism even in Europe, but especially, of course, after 1945, why capitalism began to work so well. Because capitalism, as Marx writes in volume 1 of Capital, is accumulate, accumulate, that is Moses and the prophets. Accumulate means that the capital that is produced, the products that are produced are sold and the money is plowed back into production. That means that there's also as a result of competition and the class struggle internal to production. There's a constant innovation of productive technology. Today we also have innovations. We have the iPhone and the iPad and all kind of gadgets, but there's not so much innovation in production anymore. Most of the main production lines, of course, get more computer aid, etc., but the real development of the productive forces is no longer happening. And yet, it did happen in the period from the 1930s to the 1970s. Capitalism worked best in those years. It was able to redistribute its gains across a broader layer of classes, thanks to the class compromise. It was based on a constant revolutionizing of production in the so-called Fordist system, named after Henry Ford. So workers were offered, as it were, the choice between going for socialism in whatever form, and the only form that people could imagine, of course, was the Soviet form. And plus some intellectuals had other ideas, but that was the basic imaginary that people worked with. Or they could be given the choice of having a car and a refrigerator and so on and so forth. And so the power of Fordism was enormous, also in the ideological sense, because it offered people a range of compensations, basically, for an ever more dreary form of productive life. Work was less and less interesting. It less and less relied, thanks to the productivity rises, on what you could do, you know, on your skills, and it more and more relied on machinery, on work organization, etc. So people went to their job, came back disappointed, between quotation marks, because they did not necessarily feel that emotionally, but at the end of the line there was the prospect of having a car. Although if you look at the figures, you can see that the people who actually profited from having that car were mostly middle class people. But the workers still could work a lot with the illusion, and in the United States the workers too had cars, and it was advertised by US propaganda that if you wanted to have a car and you wanted to live the life of people owning cars, then you should follow the United States in other respects as well. So these things are always interconnected. Now, while capitalism worked well because its central emphasis was on production, on the sphere of production, the sphere where the class compromise was organized, that required that other forms of capital, because capital doesn't, of course, exist as it did in the former Soviet Union, only as one long production line. It exists as a competitive system in which different components of capital constantly recombine in productive sequences via what is called the sphere of circulation. So, you know, goods circulate, then they are sold, then they circulate as money, and the money at some point ends up in capital again, productive capital. Money had to be suppressed, because liberalism had always spread as a free flow of using economic opportunities as one of its aspects. And it had to be suppressed if the class compromise with workers was to hold. You know, if capital would be free to move away from every place where its profits were substandard, then of course a class compromise wouldn't hold. And that is why when in 1933 the United States, really under Roosevelt's New Deal, began to reorient its entire economy towards this new system of Fordism, one of its first measures, and maybe the crown jewel of the whole legislative program, was the Glass-Steagall Act. And the Glass-Steagall Act suppressed speculative money capital, essentially. John Maynard Keynes, the economist, actually in the general theory of interest, employment and money, or employment, interest and money, or employment, well, one of that general theory, he speaks of the euthanasia of the rentier, French term being the recipient of dividends, interest, and other income.
Euthanasia del rentier, del percettore di rendita, yeah, del capitalismo finanziario.
Yeah, and the Glass-Steagall Act, of course, didn't prescribe that, but it prescribed that the banks separate into two branches. One was the national low-risk form of deposit banking, in which you take deposit of savers and you lend them out to businesses again, or for trade. And the other is the high-risk transnational speculative activity. And there's a lot to be said about the specific attributes of either, because money capital as deposit taking and lending out for investment is closely tied to accumulation. So it always has to be there, otherwise we can't speak of capitalism. But speculative money flows are actually not money capital, it is commercial capital, because they are not looking for opportunities for accumulation, they are looking for opportunities for commercial profit. And that is important to understand what has happened from roughly 91 to the present, in which accumulation has come to a standstill in the West, and capital has taken the form that we associate with Goldman Sachs, with the big crash that we had in 2007 to 2008, and that's still going on. Now, if we think of the period 1931 to the 1970s, we're talking about a class compromise with its center in production, with certain excessive forms of free-floating money capital suppressed, with the rentier, who was labeled by Keynes the functionless investor, the investor that is of no use in the economy, if you think about it, all placed under supervision. But the result was that within the, and we're still talking about this densely, this compact society that was spreading in this unique interval between the 1930s and the 1970s. Profits were going down, and it's of course not surprising at all. And because of a lot of circumstances I can't go into now, but maybe later in the discussion, very slowly the capitalist class was becoming aware of itself as a capitalist class again and began to mount a counterattack. So what you see in the long historical term is that the liberal offensive, the spread of liberal principles with their historic organic core in the English-speaking West, had come to a standstill and had been thrown into reverse in the 1930s. Then you get a long period of stable blocks, densely compacted society, and class compromise centrally organized in production. And in the 1970s, for a number of reasons, a few that I will mention later, the capitalist class resumes the historic offensive. And that's the offensive that we today call globalization, also because it has effectively won the game for the moment. It has won the game, of course, at a terrible price, because one of the aspects of production that I can't go into now is that nature, and we are part of nature primarily, so nature and humanity with it, are, are organized is not the word, they operate on the principle of cycles, you know, that life comes and goes, and well, I don't have to philosophize about that here. But production is linear. That it, you know, you set up a series of machines and you put people next to it, and they produce goods. And one of the production lines that is most clearly linear and that most clearly clashes with the cyclical nature of the cyclical character of nature is a petrochemical industry. So everything that follows from fossil, using fossil fuel for making plastics. You know, when I walk here in Venice, yeah, I'm not blaming you for anything, because with us it's exactly the same. We see part of the plastic bottles that are being produced, and in a magazine that I was reading on the flight here, I saw that there's 70 billion plastic bottles being produced every year. And these bottles are no longer, unlike paper bags, they are no longer cyclical. They will not recycle of their own unless we put in place very expensive, you know, we can make some road marks from shreds, etc., but it will still be plastic. 500 billion plastic bags are produced every year. Now, before I break down crying here, I see that you get my message, which is simply, we're looking at a linear process, and that linear process is in principle at odds with the natural context in which everything that we do is operating. So that is a very important aspect of production. So you might almost say that when in 1971 this famous report about the limits to growth came out by an American group of researchers at MIT, which said that we can't go on like this, they put their finger on something, on arguments that can be contested, but they put their finger on something that contributed to a deep undertow in society that the sort of golden age that we had had in the post-war years could not endure. And that was pollution in all kinds of ways, and so on and so forth. I mention it because otherwise you get the idea that neoliberalism, you know, that we were all living happily, we were dancing in the streets, waving to each other, etc. That was a good atmosphere, and suddenly the neoliberals landed in dark plains, conquered us all, and destroyed all happiness that existed. That's not true. There were aspects of society, and society is always the priority here, not the economy, but society. There were aspects in society that were becoming conscious of the fact that something was fundamentally at odds with the long-term existence. And here I should come back to, before I wind up, here I should come back to that long introduction that I gave about being at arm's length. Because in May 68, you know, you must have heard your parents about it, or maybe even your grandparents already. May 68 was this explosion of the left. You know, universities erupted and students reclaimed a say, in also because of the sheer expansion of higher education, thanks to the fact that the first post-war generation, the baby boom, was reaching university age. So there were so many people that we no longer accepted. Professors like the one I had in Roman law, this guy had a beret. He could have walked into the room on a cloud, actually, because he had no connection with anyone who was sitting there. He went to his chair and began reading further, as if he was speaking to himself about intricacies of Roman law that only somebody who had studied Roman law, let's say for 7 or 8 years, could remotely understand. We didn't understand a word, so everybody had to run to a so-called repetitor, and that was somebody who you paid privately, and he taught you what you should know for the exam. Now, that system, of course, exploded when suddenly you got all these people from the post-war generation who had seen no war, no crisis, and who wanted everybody to be at arm's length. And that was a very powerful driver, and it expressed itself in the left. Also in, you know, flower power, free love, which was, of course, I was in military service, so I'm not guilty here, but I heard about it. And so there were a lot of attractions for people who were 19, 20, you can imagine. But the undertow was liberal, and that, I think, was only fully realized later. So when I say that in 1971 there was the first, of course, there had been the famous novel about Silent Spring by Rachel Carson, but there was also, when the birds died of DDT consumption. But there was also this report that I just mentioned. These were the underlying changes in social consciousness that took on all kind of different forms. And in the culture of the late 1960s, if you think back of that we're still in this interval period from 1931 to 1979, and of course the dates now, when I mention it like this, the dates sound terribly arbitrary, but you see the point. That was a left conjuncture. If you wanted to do something new, it went to the left almost naturally. And these forces were available, but they were not recognized at first, and they provoked the counterattack of the right. And from 1968 to, let's say, 1974, you get the formation of a whole series of organisms like the Heritage Foundation in the United States, the Trilateral Commission of a slightly different ideological stripe, and a number of other organizations where people from the ruling class and those who work for them or feel emotionally or what are politically attracted to it, to its positions, come together and say, we don't want this any longer. We don't want black people in the United States demonstrating for equal rights. We don't want people protesting the Vietnam War. And we don't want, and that was, of course, was the most important thing, we don't want this socialist form of organizing state and society to spread any further, because it had been spreading. You know, in 1949 was the Chinese Revolution, 1959 was the Cuban Revolution, and in 1970, for the first time in history, there was the Chilean Unidad Popular government, in which Allende spoke in his presidential address of Marx and Engels, and Chile as the first society in which, through parliamentary majority, a socialist society might be instituted. So a lot of things were happening, and the response to May 68 was not just a counterattack against the students, because they weren't that important, but it was the beginning of a counterattack against all the forces that added up towards the end of this interval period to the spread of densely organized society. Now, I think I shouldn't go on endlessly, except to mention that the Pinochet coup in Chile in 1973 really was the first attack, not the first American-supported intervention by rulers, because in 65 we had seen a terrible massacre in Indonesia, you know, death in the millions. And the operation in Chile was called significantly Operation Jakarta. So the people who were behind and, you know, supporting these interventions saw the continuities. In 1964 you had the coup in Brazil, and so on and so forth. So that was nothing new, but what was new in Chile was that a left government had instituted itself, that it was obvious that it would not be dislodged by elections, and that some other means would have to be found to stem the tide. And Chile, of course, for you in Italy, is of crucial importance, because from what happened in Chile under Pinochet, Berlinguer in Italy drew the conclusion, in hindsight of course we can say it was mistaken, but that there is no point in confronting your own bourgeoisie, but you had to compromise with it. So he, in the spirit of the class compromise of those years, thought that the best role for the Italian Communist Party was to remain in its role as a subordinate but loyal partner. I guess I leave it there for a first round, except again for one thing, and here again you can see how the economy and economics is internal to these processes, because what happened in Chile was not just mass repression and the brutal ending of everything that the Allende government had tried to create, but also the liberation of the economy from the class compromise with labor. So the economy was cut up, there was a forcible internationalization of the Chilean economy that still endures today. But the points that I really wanted to make was that there's an economic dimension of neoliberalism, and it's not very difficult to find, but there's another dimension, and that is that liberalism rests on this idea that there is in every person a yearning, at least in part of your life, for individual freedom that you want to see realized in the society that you live. And that is why still today the United States and Britain are attractive places, why many people want to be there. I never understood, you know, as a Francophile, sort of holiday maker in France, I never understood in Britain when French young people came there and said, yeah, we like Britain. And I said, well, I don't like it at all. I think it's a terrible society, and well, it's not interesting what I thought. But what they say was that, yes, here we feel free. We feel free from a badly run state that is sitting on your neck and constraining you in every way. Here you have the feeling that you could choose your own future. Now, that is something that, of course, is very important when you're young. I can tell you that when you're 65, choosing your own future, of course, is a much less urgent matter, but you would like to feel the weight of the state on your neck. So what we're still looking for, I think, as humanity, is to find some balance in allowing a freedom to people, and at the same time having a social safety net. It sounds a bit prosaic in this sentence, but to have some sort of social bonding that is waiting for you to fall back in it, because otherwise we get young generations which are encouraged to be free, which therefore lack the ability and lack the sense of constraint that force them into stable relationships, not just the individual relationship with one other person, but stability in your own, in your entire society. But at some point we'll need that again for society to be able to reproduce and to tackle the real important issues. Maybe I should stop because the clock is beginning to sound.